Fox Sports.
We are Baltimore. We are Ohio.
The Kansas City Royals are finding out firsthand that winning a world championship and defending that title are two entirely different tasks. Last night, the Indians handed KC their first loss of the year when leading in the ninth inning. It was an exhilarating win for Cleveland and a stunning defeat for the Royals. The grit and resolve of a champion is not to be taken lightly, but neither is the hunger and desire of an underdog. Kansas City's grip on the top spot in the standings has loosened, and the Indians are closing in. The series continues next on Sports Time Ohio. Officially, I guess we're still more than a couple of weeks away from the first day of summer, but you'd never know it. In downtown Cleveland, Ohio, another spectacular evening as the Tribe continues a four-game series tonight against the Kansas City Royals. Hi again, everyone. Matt Underwood alongside Rick Manning. Last night was a ball game. The Indians came back and won it in the night. It's a bullpen in Kansas City you don't come from behind very often against. It's the first loss they've suffered this year when leading after eight innings, and the Indians did it in not necessarily conventional fashion.
Well, they got a lot of help from the Kansas City Royals, but it was also good hustle on the Indians' part as Santana's leading off the ninth. He gets the base hit into right field. You'll see the slip by Orlando right here, and Carlos kept his head up and hustled into second base. Once he sees he bobbled the ball, he hustles. He is the tying run in that situation. He gets himself into scoring position. They move him over, and then Francisco Lindor hits a ball that gets past Orlando. He gets into third base. But Orlando should have probably just laid back on this ball right here and played it into a single, because Francisco Lindor was the winning run. And what's he do? He lets the ball get past him. Lindor gets to third base, and then it's going to be Mike Napoli. It only takes a sacrifice fly to get him in for the Indians to win this ball game. They did everything they had to do, and with a little help from the Royals, they took advantage of it.
Kansas City normally is a team fundamentally very sound, but last night, uncharacteristically, they committed three errors, plus a couple of mental lapses maybe in that ninth inning cost them dearly. Danny Salazar will pitch tonight for the Tribe. The last time he faced Kansas City, a season high 7 2/3 innings and four hit shutout baseball.
Well, and Danny also likes to pitch at home, and he has such good stuff. He's tough against left-handed hitters with that great changeup he has. He beat Kansas City earlier. He's 2-0 against the Central Division this year in his three starts. So they've got the right guy on the mound to try and win the second game of this series, going up against Edison Volquez, 5-4 this year. But you can see the Indians have had his number in his career, 2-5.
Indians, Royals, round two of this four-game series. It's coming up next. Plus, when we return, Andre Knott will take us inside the Indians' victorious clubhouse from last night. You'll hear all the reaction when we come back. Cleveland Indians baseball is brought to you by W.B. Mason, the official office supplier of the Cleveland Indians. By McDonald's, I'm loving it. And by your local Toyota dealers, visit buyatoyota.com. Toyota, let's go places. are ready for baseball on a picture perfect evening in downtown Cleveland. Indians Royals. And what a win for the Cleveland Indians last night. Let's go down to Andre Knott, who was right in the middle of the celebratory atmosphere after the ball game.
Well, the excitement for last night's game began before the game even started, having Cookie Carrasco back on the mound after missing 5 weeks of action. Then the team had its second walk-off win in a row, and that gave some excitement and some encouragement for this team when they go against this Kansas City Royals ball club. Here's tonight's Here's Right sounds of the game.
First of all, seeing Santana, the way he hustled. As soon as he hit the ball, he went to second. He knew he wanted to get the second. He knew it was an important run. As soon as he missed the ball, he went to second base. He's not the fastest guy in the team, but he had that in mind, you know, and that's huge. Then Kiffy comes in, one of the best hitters in the team, sacrificed himself, you know, to do it to me. And it was just a matter of getting the barrel to the ball. I was talking to Brandon in the dugout the inning before. It's like, you're struggling. All you got to do is just focus on making hard contact. Don't worry about the hits because you're going to keep on struggling. And that's what I try to do, you know. He's one of the guys I try to imitate, and it worked.
Hitting, being contagious and things like that, I think the base running is. I think the guys take pride in it, and they should, because they're doing a good job. And it directly influences outcomes of games. Doesn't show up in the box score, but it'll show up in the win-loss column.
I mean, we need to play baseball like we did tonight, you know, taking extra bases, doing the right things, moving guys over, you know, getting clutch hits. So that's the way we need to start playing baseball, and it's a good feeling.
The Kansas City Royals won the World Series last year, being aggressive on the bases and taking the extra base when it was given. Last night and throughout this season, the Indians have tried to mimic that and do the same thing. A win over Kansas City that way last night, they hope, propels them to the rest of the weekend, guys.
You know, a pair of walk-off wins certainly does boost your energy level, and it makes everybody feel a part of it. And, you know, that's something they just have to continue to do. And it's fun to watch because they're doing it right now at the right time.
Well, that's exactly right. When you've got Kansas City in town, that's the team you're chasing. They've got what you want, and you can't let them continue to stay as hot as they had been coming into this series. We'll see if Danny Salazar can slow him down tonight. He's on the hill. Here's the lineup he will face for Ned Yost. Alcides Escobar, who was hitless last night, will lead it off. Whit Merrifield, who did not play last night, gets the start at second base. He'll bat second. Lorenzo Cain third. Then it's Eric Hosmer, Henry Morales, and Paulo Orlando. Chesler Cuthbert, who was 3-for-4 with a home run. Gerard Dyson and Drew Butera batting ninth.
And tonight's Northern Ohio Honda starting pitcher for the Tribe is Danny Salazar. He will be making his 11th start. Danny, with a record of 5-3, a 239 earned run average. He's been very good at home this year. He's 3-1 with a 161 ERA. He has beaten Kansas City. That came on May 6th. He went 7 2/3 innings, 4 hits, did not allow a run. He walked 1 and struck out 9. So it was a very, you know, good start by him. He is averaging 7 runs of support by his teammates. Let's hope they can get him some early. And then he goes out there and continues to pitch well. The defense for the Indians, brought to you by Jeep, stacks up this way. Ramirez, Naquin, and Chisenhall in the outfield. Uribe, Lindor, Kipnis, Santana on the infield with Gomes doing the catching.
Carlos Torres has the plate. Sam Holbrook at first. Jerry Davis, the crew chief, at second base. And Rob Drake is down at third. So Danny Salazar will make the start. Let me ask you this. Do you remember Salazar making a start this year
with his pants,
with the pants rolled down?
No, I don't. I don't. It's always been the stirrups, the high socks, and the big white high top shoes.
He's going with a different look tonight.
Well, that's okay. I mean, he's coming off a win against Baltimore where he went 6 innings, 6 hits. So I don't know, something new, something different.
Alcides Escobar to lead it off for Kansas City. And Salazar's first pitch hit right to Wander Uribe. A chest high bouncer throws him out, one pitch, one away. Keys to the game are brought to you by Wayside Furniture. Control the bottom of the KC order. Hitters 6 through 9 last night were a combined 9-for-16 with 4 runs scored, 4 runs batted in. And make Volquez get the ball up.
Yes, they've done a good job in their career making Volquez do it. So Good track record.
Whit Merrifield takes a pitch down low, ball one.
This kid's off to a tremendous start, isn't he?
You're not kidding.
27-year-old rookie.
He has a hit in every start he's made, which is only 11.
Right.
But that's a Royals club record.
Well, yeah, and he has 18 hits in his first 12 games. They have had some pretty good hitters come through this organization.
2-0 fastball right there. And he'll take it for a called strike. Low and away, 3-1. Our game time temperature tonight is 73 degrees. Lots of blue skies. The weather on this homestand has been just spectacular. He walked him. So Whit Merrifield aboard. 29th walk for Salazar in just over 60 innings of work. It will bring up Lorenzo Cain.
Yeah, with Merrifield in the lineup tonight, it moves Cain and Hosmer down a spot. So they'll be hitting 3-4 as opposed to 2-3 like they did last night.
Cain was 2-for-5 last night, three straight multi-hit games. As he has just been locked in offensively over the last month. He's had nine multiple hit games since May 21st.
Well, and he has pretty good numbers against Salazar, 8-for-20 in his career.
Off speed pitch in for a strike. During a six game hitting streak, couple of homers, nine runs batted in. Fastball took off on him.
Always something we watch early in a Salazar start is the command of the fastball in the first inning.
And a high strike called, much to the dismay of King. He falls behind on the count now, 1-2.
Well, as a hitter, you don't want to swing at this pitch from Salazar. That's much like Ventura last night, Matty. But that high fastball, it's so hard to get on top of. You want to make him get it down, but if he starts calling that pitch, that could fare well for a fastball pitcher like Salazar.
Breaking ball hit to first. Santana had trouble getting it out of the glove. They get their force at second, back to first. Cain beats it out by a whisker.
Well, I think you hit it the nail on the head. He had a tough time getting it out of his glove on the first couple of steps. It went in there, or they might have been able to turn it if he was able to get a good throw to Lindor. You see, he sort of stutter step. Had a tough time getting it out, and that enabled Cain to beat it out. Salazar did a nice job of getting over there, but the return throw not in time.
So Cain at first base with two down. Indians took a look at the video and decided not to challenge, and rightfully so.
It yeah, he
definitely
beat it
looked
out.
Like he beat it out.
Yes, indeed.
Eric Hosmer last night, 1-for-2 in the ballgame. He walked twice. What a block by Gomes, but Cain read it well and was off as soon as he saw the ball hit the dirt.
That one was almost impossible to block right there. I mean, look how far in front of the plate that this ball hits, and Gomes did everything in his part. Nothing you can do. You see where that ball has spin to it? It goes the opposite way. Gomes tried to keep it in front, but no. They'll send Cain down to second base on Salazar's second wild pitch.
Now they'll just put Hosmer on.
That's a good idea. I like that.
Well, and that's a case where, Rick, a year ago, Kendry Morales was fantastic for Kansas City, and he made you pay if you walked Hosmer or tried to work around somebody. This year, he's not having the same magic in the bat.
No, he's under 200 as a hitter. Hey, not that he can't hurt you, but, you know, Hosmer is 7 for his last 13 with runners in scoring position while driving in 14. So, you know what? Take the bat out of his hand and make Morales drive you in. I agree with that.
For Kansas City, batting fifth, the designated hitter, number 25, Kendrys Morales.
You know, you may see these two guys on base a lot throughout the course of this four-game series. I'm talking about Kane and Hosmer. Just make sure they're not driving in guys in front of them.
Well, Kendry Morales started the year 3 for 24 with runners in scoring position. So I think because of that, Rick, teams that scouted Kansas City, that the formula was put in place when teams saw that. They said, hey, Morales is struggling to drive in runs. Don't pitch to Kane and Hosmer. Make Morales beat you.
Well, when you have guys like Gordon in there, Moustakas in there, and Salvador Perez, that's a totally different thing now. Now you've got to deal with some all-stars.
The 0-1 fouled back.
This guy will get it going, though, throughout the course of the year. And when he does, then you can be in some trouble.
Well, you know, on the last homestand, he was 5 out of 13. A couple of runs scored, hit a homer, drove in 4. So they were probably thinking, all right, he's getting hot now.
That's what a lot of guys are doing to Washington, to Harper. They're not throwing him strikes to hit and drive in runs. So they walk him, and whoever's hitting behind him, you have to start hitting and producing. And then maybe they'll quit the walks.
Two down, two strike pitch. Swung on and miss. He struck him out with a sizzling fastball at 96 miles an hour. No runs, no hits, two left. The Indians are coming to bat. Here at Progressive Field, Carlos Santana will lead things off for Terry Francona and the Indians. The rest of the lineup presented by Progressive. Jason Kipnis bat second. Francisco Lindor, two hits last night, two runs scored, including the game winner. Mike Napoli drove home Lindor to win the ballgame. Jose Ramirez fifth, and Lonnie Chisenhall. Juan Uribe, Yan Gomes, and Tyler Naquin. Old Edinson Volquez. He'll turn 33 1 month from today. The Dominican Republic native won 13 games for the second straight season a year ago. And he misses ball one to Santana. Carlos last night hitless his first four trips, but then singled and alertly went to second on the misplay in right field to open the bottom of the ninth.
He was hitting a lot of balls in the air last night. I mean sky high. A long swing up until that ninth inning when he worked the count and got the base hit.
Upstairs 3-0.
The last time Volquez pitched against the Indians, he walked four batters in 4 1/3 innings. They were able to get 7 hits and 4 walks. He ended up giving up 5 runs. They made him work hard in that ball game.
And the 3-0 finds the strike zone. And it's up high, ball four.
Well, let's check out the Northern Ohio Hyundai starting pitcher for the Royals, Edison Volquez, who is 32 years old, making his 12th start. That leads the team. 5-4 personal record, but the Royals are 7-4 in his starts. He averages about 16.5 pitches per inning. On the road, he has struggled. 2-2 with a 6.55, a high ERA. Opposition hitting just 2.65 off him.
That number jumps out at you, almost 7.
Yeah.
On the road.
Well, they have such a good ballpark to pitch in Kansas City. It's about as spacious as you can get. Hot.
Santana at first with Kipnis at the plate. And it's quickly 0-2.
Yeah, Volquez has been streaky this year. He's been trendy. 3-0 in his first 4 starts. He lost his next 3 after that. And now is 2-1 in his last 4. So it's been hot, cold, hot again.
Pulled foul. Well, it's taken a while, but at age 32, he's put together the best back-to-back years of his entire career with 26 wins.
He's one of those guys that made his way through Pittsburgh and had a year and really turned his career around over there after Cincinnati. You remember he went out and then Pittsburgh really turned him around. I don't know if Ray Surge had anything to do with it or not.
Well, at some point, Rick, it's not just coincidence, right?
You don't think so.
But in all fairness, after Cincinnati traded him to San Diego in the Yonder Alonso deal, he went 11-11 for the Padres and then 9-10 for the Padres. But his ERA was over 6 that year.
Right. And that's in San Diego, a good place to pitch.
But then, as you said, the 13-7 year with Pittsburgh turned it all around.
Yes.
ERA went from 6 to 3.04. Is taking its low, 1-2.
This is where Volquez is tough when he gets ahead of you, and then he, you know, he can throw that little split or change up and make you chase. Velocity still very good. He can get up about 94.
Upstairs, 2-2. Volquez signed a 2-year contract with Kansas City, so last year and this year, plus there's one of those mutual options for the 2017 campaign, which if I remember right, the mutual option, they both have to agree.
Right. So team, and yes, so he may want to come back. If the team doesn't want him, then
they can say no, or he can say no, I want to go to free agency. And the 2-2 low and in with a breaking ball. So a good at bat.
Yes.
Here for Kipnis. Being patient against a guy that's not sometimes easy to be patient against.
Yeah, from 0-2 to 3-2. I want to see if we start Santana here. Thinking that Kipnis will put it in play. They feel they might, so they throw to first. As always, that first baseman and the base runner looking into the sunshine early in the ball game here.
Santana's itching to go. He's off. And the 3-2 pitch is in the dirt. Back-to-back walks to start the game. And what has to be troubling for the Royals is that he had Kipnis down 0-2.
Right.
Our great clip of the game from last night. Francisco Lindor roping one into the gap. And it's interesting, if you watch that replay, when Frankie hit the ball, his first four steps out of the box, he's thinking, he's going to catch it and I'm going to be out. And then he took off.
Yeah.
And he admitted after the game, he goes, I made a mistake here. I should have been running hard right from the get-go. But once he saw the ball get down, he was running like the wind was at his back because he went all the way to third base with ease. And that was a huge, huge hit in the ball game. Lindor showing bunt taking. It's a strike. I don't think he had intentions of actually bunting there. I think he was probably just getting a good look at that first pitch.
If he does, he's doing it on his own, and it's because he hasn't been swinging the bat that well on the homestand, but he's swung it well against the Royals in his career. First inning. There you go.
Hammer deep foul right side into the crowd. Just got a little bit too far out in front of him.
I'm sure that's what Tito wants to see in the first inning.
Now watch Lindor last night out of the box. He's like, oh man. And then whoop. Okay.
Yeah, the point being, even if he catches that ball, it's going to be a sacrifice fly because Martinez would have scored there. Ends up being a triple because Orlando dove for that ball and it got by him.
Well, here's Lindor now in the hole 0-2. I like what he told Mike Andre after the ball game, that he had been talking to Michael Brantley in the dugout before that at bat. Michael's saying to him, just work on barreling the ball up. Don't worry about getting hits. Worry about making good solid contact. Hits will come from good solid contact. And it's amazing, even a major leaguer needs to be reinforced with that idea once in a while.
Well, yeah, I mean, he's just about a year into his career, his first year, even though this is his second season. He's played about a full year in baseball, and there's still a lot to learn.
Taking a tough pitch inside, 1-2.
For Volquez, in his first 11 starts this year, in the first inning, he walked three guys. Well, he's walked the first two here. And historically, you know, with his time in Kansas City, he gives up runs in that first inning. It's looking good for the opposition.
And a good cut by Lindor just to stay alive with that fastball.
He's 18-13, you know, in his career in Kansas City. He's allowed just one run in the first inning of his 18 victories. But in his 13 defeats, he's allowed 7 earned runs.
That one almost went to the backstop, and a nice job by Butera to jump up out of that crouch and corral it. And you can see that Volquez here in this first inning, Rick, he's searching for it.
Yes, he is. He's searching for it, is right. He's been able to get ahead, but can't put him away. Sometimes that's starters, it takes a while to get a feel for all their pitches.
Only 8 of the 18 pitches so far have been strikes. And again, he's going to step off. They're having a tough time getting on the same page.
Yes,
he's ready now.
Are.
Lindor fouling it back out of play.
Yeah, this is the third time he's been out there in this inning to talk to him. You're right. Whatever Butera is putting down, Volquez isn't buying.
Well, I think, you know, too, when you look at Edinson Volquez, not only is he a veteran who has all the regular season experience, but he has pitched 7 games in postseason play, including last year in the World Series for the Royals. The 2-2. Got him to chase it.
That was a good off-speed pitch.
And the first out of the inning.
pulled the string and it was excellent location. Watch him pull the string. Looks like a strike. Looks like a strike. It gets out of the zone. Good pitch. Strikeout number one. Now the defense behind Volquez is Dyson in left, Kane in center, Orlando is in right. Cuthbert at third, Escobar at short, Merrifield at second, Hosmer at first, Butera behind the plate.
Now here's Mike Napoli. Last night, 2 for 4, scored twice. And a foul back off the mask of Butera. It's amazing to me, Rick, how many times I've seen Mike Napoli go up and get after a pitch early in an at bat, and yet still ends up grinding his way through four or five pitches in the at bat.
He's a veteran hitter, and he knows when you get runners in scoring position, the best pitch may be the first pitch. So, you know, he's a patient hitter, but not when you get guys in scoring position. Like a lot of good RBI guys, they'll get after it early if they get the pitch they're looking for. And then, you know, they'll settle in. They take their one shot, and then, okay, reality sets in. He was down 0-2 last night when he drove in the game-winning run on the sacrifice fly. He shortened his swing. And he's going to have to do something here now. He's down in the count, 1-2.
He did not like that call by Carlos Torres.
Check it out on our Nissan pitch tracker. Good pitch. Mike likes it down there.
Two on, one out. We're in the first. No score. And he strikes him out. Back-to-back K's after walking the first two to start the game.
Well, there's something that clicked and comes back with another breaking ball. So his strikeouts on the curveball. He was a little erratic with Santana and Kipnis, but now he battles back. It's a 2-2. Now he's going to have to face the league's leading hitter with runners in scoring position.
Ramirez. Jose Ramirez
hitting 400, tied with Xander Bogaerts.
2 for 4 last night. And takes that breaking ball down and in. But this is the situation you really want him in. He's 9 for 20.
Yeah,
there are two outs.
He's been unbelievable. This guy has been a clutch hitter for the Indians.
Outside 2-0. Stat of the game brought to you by Buick. He's hitting roughly 300 when the bases are empty. Up to 357 when they're on. 400 when they're in scoring position. 450.
And believe me, it gets tougher as you go down that list, and he gets better.
Well, I think a lot of it goes back to the good old Ted Williams philosophy. When you're at the plate, what's the first rule? Get a good pitch to hit. And from what I've seen from Ramirez, Rick, he gets in these situations.
Not too aggressive.
Yeah, he's not tensing up. He's letting the game come to him.
Well, when you get off to a good start sometime.
And a line drive snared by Hosmer on the 3-0 pitch. So the inning started promising. But it ends with a thud. No score after one.
that app. You can stay connected all season with radio broadcasts, video highlights, stats, news, and more. Download MLB.com at bat, the number one app for live baseball on your smartphone and tablet.
Second inning here at Progressive Field, and Paulo Orlando will lead it off. I had to check to see if maybe he dropped the O from his name. The scoreboard has him listed as Paul Orlando.
Well, maybe they're his friend.
Yo, Paulie. Still officially listed as Paulo by the Royals, but I wonder, you never know anymore.
That's true. They change their names a lot.
Here's the 2-1 now. And Orlando swings through a good fastball from Salazar. So each pitcher with a couple of walks in the first inning. Although one for Salazar was intentional. And he got Orlando to go fish for a good slider down and away. Second strikeout, one away.
Like an off-speed pitch here by Salazar. Nice changeup. Make that our Circle K strikeout tonight. Gets his second consecutive.
Here's Chesler Cuthbert. Looks at a high fastball.
When he hit his home run yesterday in that sixth inning, the Royals set a club record with their 10th consecutive game with at least 10 hits. That's how hot they've been. And the Royals coming in now, they're 10th in the league in runs scored. They've scored 220.
That Cuthbert was hot last night, 3 out of 4 with a home run. A little bit low, 3 balls on the strike. But what a bonus for Kansas City to have a guy like Cuthbert step right in with Moustakas on the DL. Man, that's
not easy to do.
No.
That one not close. But Danny already with his third walk.
The injury report brought to you by the attorneys at Elk and Elk. David Wright continues to be bothered with a neck problem. Connor Pence, a right hamstring, has landed him on the DL for the Western Division leaders in the National League. San Francisco began the day 5.5 games better than the Dodgers. The Mets, 3 games back of the Nationals in the NL East. Here is Jerod Dyson. He had 2 hits last night. Curveball here right to Lindor. He'll tag the bag. Throw to first. Double play.
Second double play in as many nights.
Ends the inning. Jerod Dyson, the speedster, gets into the Twin Killer. Middle of the second. No score in Cleveland. No score, bottom of the second inning. And leading off for Cleveland will be Lonnie Chisholm. He looks at a ball down low.
Well, you can tell Chisholm seeing the ball very well. A lot of his takes are right there. He's making him put it in the strike zone to something he likes, and he's swinging it with authority now.
I'm telling you, I think maybe his vision was a little off. He slid in and ran his head into Jonathan Scope, and it knocked everything back into alignment. He's been on fire ever since.
Yeah.
Here's a line drive to center. Deep center. Back is Kane, and look at that. He makes it look so effortless. One down.
Yeah, tough to get it over his head.
Let's go downstairs to Andre. I mentioned the story that Francisco Lindor relayed to you last night after the ball game about Brantley telling him, hey, just try to barrel the ball up. Don't worry about the hits. Don't fall. What is he doing? Not able to get on the field. How is he keeping himself involved?
He's keeping himself. Well, tonight he's becoming a bat boy. If you see, he's right next to the bat boys. We can pan out right there. The bat boy told me they're teaching him some things tonight about how to bat boy. I joke when I say that, but he's really helping out all the hitters. He's really watching what the pitchers are doing. He's keeping himself in the game is what he told me. It's frustrating that he's not playing, but he says, I'm going to keep my mind in it, and I'm going to let guys know, you know, what I see and try to help them as much as I can if they're willing to listen to me. Last night helped get a victory. You don't put it next to his name, but I know he felt a little bit better when he knew that Francisco actually paid attention to what was said and helped him out.
Well, when you're on the disabled list, you really feel, you know, out of the picture. You don't feel part of the team unless you're playing. So you got to get in there. You have to try and do something. And mentally, he is. He's checking it out.
Well, Uribe has checked on both, and they've called strikes on the swing both times. He's going to throw him one out of the strike zone again.
Why wouldn't you?
Change up and strikes him out.
That was quick. Well, you can bring the heat this weekend. Continues tomorrow night when 12,500 fans will get the 1976 throwback jersey and postgame fireworks. It'll pay a tribute to David Bowie, Glenn Frey, and Prince. Visit Indians.com and get your tickets today.
Now the batter is Yan Gomes, and he looks at a ball in the dirt. Gomes jolts one to deep left field. Gone to Souvenir City. Yan Gomes, home run number 7 of the year. And the Indians strike first and lead it 1-0. Well, Gomes, I think for the rest of the year, just don't look at the batting average. He's doing well with runners in scoring position. He's got 27 RBIs now and 7 home runs.
Looked like a little two-seam fastball down in his wheelhouse that he likes it. And he put a nice swing on that baseball, jumped off his bat. In one swing, the Indians will take the lead, 1-0. 57th home run.
And with 2 down, Tyler Naquin to the plate, looks at a ball outside. Naquin last night came up with a key hit for the Indians in the 8th inning, a 2-out RBI single that enabled them to get within a run of Kansas City. When you think about that Royals bullpen, not many teams will score a run in the 8th and then 2 in the 9th.
Well, that's when they didn't turn the double play in that 8th inning.
Yeah.
And it prolonged it. It gave Naquin an opportunity to get the extra out. He made him pay.
In the air, left field, over near the line, Dyson. And in the corner makes the grab. The inning is over. But Yan Gomes going gone. And the Indians lead it 1-0. inning. Danny Salazar on the hill, where Scott Bales used to call that his office once upon a time. He joins us here in the booth.
Where's your
Indians
red shirt
alumni
tonight,
weekend?
Brother? Alumni weekend.
You got a little bit of red there.
I got the, yeah, they go other colors. Bobby D's using other colors, but it's good. And this was mine was the mistake on the lake down the hill, where Archie also ran around the
outfield.
That's
the only place I did. Yeah.
I pitched here as a visiting team, but never as an Indian.
When you were a Ranger?
A Ranger and an Angel.
Okay.
Drew Butera, he blasts one to deep left field, and we are tied at one.
Well, that lead didn't last long. Thanks for coming on, Scotty. We'll see you next year.
Okay, great. Good to see you.
Just like old times.
I'm pretty sure, as a guest, I'm 4-0. I've been keeping the stats.
Okay.
I've done this four times, so I think we're good tonight.
All right. Butera hit his first yesterday and didn't waste any time. Hit a breaking ball. And that's a hanging curveball. And he left up about belt high, and Butera is on fire. Back-to-back nights with home runs. So he's hit number one and number two.
What would you say was the biggest difference that you can remember between Cleveland Stadium and Progressive Field?
Really nice and really horrible are the two things that come to mind. And I was walking around the stadium early about four today. This I can't believe this stadium's 20 years old.
Yeah.
Everything's new from 2 years ago. And
yeah,
from
the
a year.
Scoreboard. And
scoreboard, right field, behind home plate, the standing area down the left field line. It's like I come once a year and it looks new to me.
Kind of reinvented itself on the fly.
It really has. It's beautiful. And there was nothing beautiful down at the other stadium.
Sure there was.
Side by
clubhouses,
side by
showers,
the shower, we all used.
You know, did you see who's in town tonight? Speaking of Johnny Gorel.
No.
Yes, he is. The Mullion's in town.
Mullion, I will go find him.
Johnny Gorel has been in baseball for what, Matty, 60 years?
I think
close
to it.
Is he still working for the tribe?
Yes, he was in uniform. He, you know, he goes and stops and sees the minor league teams twice a year. So Johnny is in the house. Yes. So make sure you see.
I don't think I've ever had a coach yell at me more than Johnny Gorel. And he wasn't even the pitching coach.
And probably nobody that deserved it more.
I was by the book.
Salazar's third strikeout.
So Bobby DiBiasio said I had to mention because there are a few openings for fantasy camp.
Okay. It's coming in mid-January out in Goodyear, Arizona.
We'll all be there. It's a great week.
It is.
And just to ruin your day, Bill Schubert says there are 232 days till fantasy camp.
Okay, you got to leave now.
There's a fly ball deep left. Ramirez backpedaling, and he'll make the catch right in front of the wall. Round number two. Well, Bill sent me a text in case you came on that, and he wanted me to let you know it's 226 days.
I usually don't listen to anything he says, and it shows again that I didn't. But I don't remember left field wall looking so close.
Well,
it's a
that
home
has
run
not
porch.
Moved.
It's a it's home
the,
run.
I'll
porch.
Tell you, this is a legitimate stadium. This is not an easy one to hit them out of. You have to earn it here. Now we're waiting to see. Throughout the summer, you know, with the new configurations, and they had some openings behind home plate, the way the ball will travel. It may play smaller this year than it has in the past, but this is a legitimate home run park, believe it or not.
Left field just looks from this vantage point.
Yeah.
I guess it's the tall wall, just like at Fenway. It looks right on top of it.
It's half the size of Fenway's.
Enjoying the summer?
Everything's good. Still doing my little gig in Springfield, Missouri with the Double A Cardinals, and we also got a new scoreboard. It's about 1/18th the size of that thing.
Well, a home run by Drew Butera gets the Royals on the board. We're even at one. Thanks for stopping by.
Thanks. Always great. Always great. You get another lefty next inning.
Scotty Bales with us here. 1-1, middle of the third. Matt Underwood, Rick Manning. 1-1 our score. Bottom of the third, Carlos Santana, top of the order for the Tribe, and we're joined now in the booth by former Indians pitcher Sid Manji. How are you, sir?
Oh, I'm great. I'm great. And, you know, I wish I was younger.
Well, we all do, but you still look great, man.
Thank you. Appreciate it. It's great to be here. I mean, this is home. You have no idea what the feeling is. I got here at 10 o'clock. I wouldn't go to sleep until 2 in the morning. You said you're not pitching, okay? It's key down. I said, natural. But this is beautiful. State of the arts. Unbelievable. I feel at home.
Yeah.
Everybody makes me feel at home.
That's great.
Oh, wow.
77 to 1981 you spent here. Oh, best year being 1979, huh?
Yes, sir.
All-star that year. 12 and 10. Uh-huh. 20. Well, how many saves? 19 saves?
19. Oh, wow. You got them better than I did.
Well, yeah, 19 saves and 76 appearances.
Uh-huh. And Bobby Howard just broke the record. He's got rubber arm and, you know, great pitcher. Great pitcher.
Well, you used to have a rubber arm. I'll tell you that, man. About 131 innings in that year coming out of the bullpen. Can you imagine guys throwing 130 innings now?
No.
Starters don't even do that.
Well, you think about it now, Rick. If a guy gets 80 to 100 innings, that's a ton out of the bullpen now.
Yeah. What a year that was. What would that command on today's market that year?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Let me be your agent.
There you go. Oh, you get 20% easily. Oh, yeah. But
that was fun years, huh? Dave Garcia here.
And everybody, Robinson, Torboy, you name them, Kuiper, Verizer. You never talk, but he could turn that double play. Yeah. Oh, Jesus. Oh, wow.
Jason Kipnis walked his first time up. What do you remember most about your time in Cleveland pitching for the Indians?
My friendship with all the people around. We had people yelling at you in the bullpen all the time, and they were friendly. We were like, you know, I just really enjoyed it. I this is like Tucson. This is like Mazatlan. I live in Mexico also, and I feel great being here. I really from the bottom of my heart, I said, and I'll tell you what, going back to 81, I resigned for 3 years, and then Mr. Sankey traded me only a week later. But it would have been, who knows.
That's a gapper. Kipnis finds one to the wall. He's headed for second base, and he'll go in standing with a double.
Well, it's hard to split this outfield with Kane out in center, but Kipnis able to drive the ball to left center, gets his 10th double. He split it perfectly. It was a breaking ball, a curveball from Valquez that he's had success with getting strikeouts, but this one's going for a double. Now the Indians with an opportunity with a runner in scoring position.
Sid, what did players like yourself and Fernando Valenzuela mean to the baseball fans of Mexico when you guys came to the major leagues and had the success that you did?
Fernando is like, you know, obviously he won like 187 games in the big leagues, 20 game winner and all that, rookie of the year, Cy Young. I mean, it just became more apparent because they're soccer
oriented. Yeah, they're number
totally
one.
And baseball became more apparent in Mexico. And they got quite a few academies now, and it's growing.
Kipnis will go to third on the wild pitch, but it'll never overtake soccer, is what you're telling me.
No, it won't. It won't. But it's there. It's coming.
See. You remember we went down to Mexico City and played in spring training, three games down there in
1978.
Yeah, and there's people that always go down. There's usually a couple games down in Mexico City, and I see where the commissioner had mentioned, you know, Mexico City and Montreal opportunities where they would like to expand.
Wow.
When it comes into play.
Yeah. I would think that it would be successful. I don't know if you geographically it's quite a ways away, but when you got Mexico City like 26 million people within a 50-mile radius, and if you built a stadium like this, they would come.
Oh,
it would become a religion. It would be. I can believe it. Monterrey, Mexico would be another one. They got within 25-mile radius, 12 million people.
And you're still coaching down in Mexico, correct?
Yes, sir. Uh-huh.
It's still in your blood.
Lindor looks, another ball in the dirt. Butera blocked that one.
As long as St. Pete doesn't call, that's all. That's all. We keep going because baseball is oxygen.
It keeps you young.
Exactly. No, you have no idea. The knees hurt. The shoulder hurts. The brain don't hurt, and the heart doesn't hurt.
Well, when you put the it doesn't matter how old you are. When you put a uniform on, a baseball uniform, and go between the lines, it makes you feel like you're 16 again. I know that.
It's electric.
Infield is in for Kansas City. Edinson Volquez with one out. He struck Lindor out his first time up. The 2-1. Hammered right back up the middle, and the Indians take the lead. So Lindor with a line drive shot right back through the box.
That kid's electric, isn't he?
Yeah, but he's fun to watch. He's got a great personality. And let's make this our AT&T high speed replay. Line drive right back up the middle. The wild pitch helped.
Hang him, you bang him.
Yes, indeed. Right over the head of Volquez. So now the Indians come back and answer that home run put on the board by Kansas City.
Sid, I know when you and Rick were playing at Old Cleveland Stadium, they weren't the best of times necessarily for Cleveland Indians baseball, but you quickly became, from what I remember, a fan favorite. Were you able to feel that from the crowd, from the fans?
You're playing at home, it was like Yankee Stadium, period, okay? I mean, it's just like I told you, we had a relationship with people.
They were loyal. The ones that showed up, they were loyal people.
Uh-huh. I've said hello to about 100 of them. Okay.
Every day.
Yeah. Well, I'm in touch with a lot of people. I mean, I don't know when I'm going to get out. I really don't know. I have no idea.
This is great. You're getting a break from that heat in the desert.
Napoli deep to left over the head of Dyson. Lindor flying around third. They're going to wave him home.
Oh, yeah. Got it.
And he will score standing. Napoli with an RBI double.
Yeah, once that ball gets over the head of Dyson, Lindor was off and running, and what he did, he missed his cutoff man, and it enabled where they didn't even have a throw at home plate. I want to watch it again. That ball, he really couldn't make a jump at it. Gets over his head, hit sharply, and here comes Lindor. He wanted to make sure it gets over his head first, put it down, and keep turning. Makes our ball sends him all the way.
Pennant fever in Cleveland.
It's getting there. It's getting here.
I'm telling you, it's here. It's here.
Three what straight a, hits.
What a rotation, huh, for these kids.
It's fun to watch.
Oh, wow.
Jose Ramirez takes a strike.
Were you here last night?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we had an opportunity to get Carrasco back, who, you know, he's been on the disabled list for five weeks, but, you know, he came back and
did okay.
He did okay, but he's missed some time. But you get this rotation together, it's fun to watch. You'll be here all weekend. Enjoy it.
Yes, sir. I sure will. Every minute of it. I'll sleep when I get to Tucson. Forget it.
We gotta give him a break. He told me it's 110 out in Tucson now.
That's okay. Not a problem.
And, you know, Tito, the manager, lives down in Tucson in the offseason. Exactly. I know you know that.
He loves the heat.
Yeah, he does. He does. Yeah. What a great manager. I'm sorry. I know him. Little bit, you know. I never worked with him or anything, but I hear a lot of good things.
Yeah, he's a lot of fun to be around, and he's a great guy. He's a baseball lifer. He loves it. Mm-hmm.
Now the 1-1 pitch, and Ramirez with a liner in the left field, coming around third. Napoli and Sarba puts the brakes on him.
Yeah,
and probably a good idea. Dyson has a good arm, and he got to that ball quickly.
Well, and you know, with his feet set, he does have a good arm. He has 6 assists as an outfielder, so he didn't want to take a chance. No reason to take a chance here, and that's another breaking ball. So he's been beat with the breaking ball a couple times by the left-handers in this inning. And you can see he gets the ball before Napoli gets the third. And left field, a shorter throw, so wisely held up there by Sarbaugh. Hey, Sid, I got to tell you, we love it. Your offense for us, Scott Bales comes in and he's one pitch and he gets a home run for the opposition. What are we doing? You're not allowed on anymore.
Bales is saying, I'm going to 5-0 right now. Yeah. That's all he's talking about.
I.
We win, stay until Tuesday. That's all there is to it.
That's right.
We'll go on the road.
Prolong your flights. Yeah, we're going to Seattle, by the way. You may not want to go all the way up there.
We'll get away from Cy.
4 straight hits in the inning for Cleveland. Edinson Volquez facing Lonnie Chisenhall now. Lonnie drove one to deep center his last time up, and there's a ball that gets away. Coming home to score is Napoli. Ramirez down to second. A 3-run third for Cleveland.
Well, that's the second wild pitch.
You know what? Great, great wonders with the internet today. And I'm telling you, I will. NL scores, major league scores, right away, especially right now.
That's, I don't know about you guys. I think that's a pass ball.
Well, it could have. He got lazy on that ball.
Yes, he did.
He got lazy because that ball didn't.
His knees didn't go down right away.
Yeah. I mean,
he tried to do this.
Well, his body didn't move. He tried to backhand it, you know, with a man on third base. You can't let that ball get past
you. Become a wall. That's what Dave Ricketts used to say. You become a wall. Lock it first and then go from there.
Right.
You know, when you try to play like a first baseman, I mean, it just doesn't work.
Well, everybody moves up.
Thank
the Indians
you.
With three in the inning.
Could be more. More in the making.
They did rule it a wild pitch, but I don't know.
They could rule it anything they want. The Indians get a run. That's the bottom line.
Right on, brother. 2-0 pitch. Mm-hmm. And a foul back.
Good swing.
Inning began with a Carlos Santana ground up, but then Kipnis doubled to left center. Lindor drove him home with a solid line drive single into center field. Then Napoli doubled off the wall and left. Ramirez with an opposite field hit to left.
This is what we were talking about a few days ago for the Indians in the first three innings of a ball game. When you can put a big crooked number up there is when they've fared the best throughout the course of this year.
And Rick. They've won their last seven games in a row when they've scored first. 2-1 pitch. And a swing and a miss, 2-2. You know, Sid, we always joke, and it seems so simple. You score the first run, and then they got to score two to beat you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it seems so simple, and yet that is a really successful formula in baseball. If you get the first run, your percentages of winning go up dramatically.
Dave Garcia used to say that all the time. We got one, they got to get two.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, if you're a pitching coach, what do you tell your pitcher? Give me strike one.
Yeah.
First pitch, most important pitch of the sequence, right? Strike one.
Mm-hmm. You're ahead in the count. Get ahead, get him in, get him out. Simple as that. Eliminate the deep count.
Yeah, and that's what a lot. Now there's numbers and everything that go around, and it can be, it sounds complicated, but if you keep it simple, it's a game of ones, man. The first.
There you go.
First pitch strike, first pitch out, first run on the board.
Minimize damage.
And minimize the damage of crooked numbers.
You know, Sid, the one thing that Rick has really taught me in terms of the pitcher batter matchup is that when you're ahead in the count as a pitcher, the hitter becomes more defensive. He can't be as selective. And it's just that little seed of doubt, just that little split second of doubt that gives you, the pitcher, such an advantage when you're ahead in the count.
When you're ahead, he's got to come to me. And here comes a splitter, he comes sidearm, he comes something strange coming at you, you know.
Two down as Chisenhall strikes out for the second out in the inning. Which goes back to your point about that first pit, that first strike. Get that first strike, and all of a sudden, the odds dramatically increase in your favor as a pitcher.
You got that right.
You know, when we played, they never had video that they watch nowadays. I mean, there's no secrets in baseball anymore.
No.
You know what I mean?
They're not kept where it was.
There were fraternities, pitchers, you know, you tell other pitchers how to get certain hitters out and things like that. But nowadays, the video does it all.
Yeah.
Second baseman Whit Merrifield will throw out Juan Uribe. Sid, thanks so much for stopping. It was great to catch up with you. Great to see you here.
Right.
Sid Mangi with us here, and the Indians rally for three to take a 4-1 lead. in later in the game for Miller Time.
Brought to you by Miller Lite.
Uh-oh, they're lining them up, Arch.
Uh-oh.
It's a Friday night in Cleveland.
Yes, it is. Here we go.
Eric Hosmer will lead off the fourth inning for Kansas City. And Danny Salazar, a fastball four strike. And that is a foul ball by inches.
Do you think Sid liked this ballpark in the town of Cleveland?
I have to tell you, I really enjoy talking to people like that who have such an appreciation for what it is that they did in the game of baseball. I mean, you can tell that here's a guy who just really appreciates what the game gave him, what he's given back to the game. I mean, you could just
the feel town it. He played in. Yeah. He loved it here.
There's no bigger
buzzkill. He didn't want to leave. We had to get security to get him out.
I'm telling you, there's no bigger buzzkill than to meet a guy who's just bitter. Bitter because these guys make more money, or bitter because this and that and the other thing. I just really enjoyed spending time with him.
Yeah, he's a lot of fun. And, you know, he's been to fantasy camp many times, and he treats those people very special. Nice play.
Juan Uribe spins around and throws out Hosmer. One down. Uh-oh. Andre's in the district. That can't mean anything good.
What do you mean that can't mean anything good? I came out here to see all the great signs, all the great people on a Friday night here in the district. And
do they have a different sign?
It's a different sign.
Party at Napoli's.
Party at Napoli's, baby. I think he even likes it. I think the slogan is going to get big. Don't forget, you can go to Indians.com to pick up your ticket here. Great weekend ahead. 1976 jersey tomorrow night. Blue jersey. But I think the guy sitting up to you next to you wore at one point in time.
Yep.
Great time out here in the district here at Progressive Field.
All right, thanks, Andre.
Thanks for your last
Don't
cut in tonight,
long.
Brother.
See you tomorrow.
Yeah, no, y'all see you Sunday.
Yeah. You won't see me tomorrow unless you're barbecuing in my backyard. There's a fly ball to deep left for out number two. Tomorrow's game can be seen on your local Fox station. Rick and I and Andre will
have 7 o'clock start
the night
tomorrow.
Off. Yeah. And then we'll be back with you on Sunday to wrap up the homestand. Two down for Paulo Orlando.
Yeah, but a nice matchup tomorrow. It's Tomlin against Ian Kennedy. 7:15 start. There you go.
Yeah, FS1 has the Rays and Twins tomorrow at 3:30. And then Indians Royals at 7 Eastern on your local Fox station. Swing and a foul tip. By the way, Rick, you asked me, Johnny Gorel, 65th consecutive season in professional baseball.
Wow, I knew it was around 60, but it's 65 now. That's incredible, isn't it?
35 straight with the Indians.
Boy, I hope he's going to be here Sunday. Yeah, well, he was coaching third baseman I played here.
Now the 1-2. Tied him up with a good fastball. Boy, Danny Salazar, after they score him three, shut down inning. 1-2-3 go the Royals. gentleman we were referring to in his 65th consecutive season in professional baseball, 35th straight with the Indians. He's talking to Matt Quattaro. But to Johnny's right is Chris Gimenez. And before the game, he told Chris Gimenez, he says, man, I remember watching you just absolutely tear up a ballpark in Lexington, Kentucky. And Gimenez said, yeah, I hit 3 home runs in that game. I mean, think about all the years he's been, all the games he's seen, all the players. But he had that, he saw Chris Gimenez and instantly recalled that series in the minor leagues from God knows how long ago.
Well, Johnny's always been the guy around here in the minor league organization, knows all the kids, all the number one draft picks and everything that went on through here. You know, when you're a baseball guy like him, you don't forget. I mean, even somebody that 20 years ago was in the minor leagues or something, and you saw him have a good day, you remember that stuff like that. What a guy. One of the true gentlemen, ambassadors for baseball. You know, we heard Sid say, gosh, I feel old, you know, the knees are sore, but I love the game. Well, that's what happens, you know. You got to put your fungo bats down and your other things, but you can still get in a uniform and come out there and watch it.
1-2 pitch, and Gomes with a ground ball to third. Backhanded by Cuthbert. And he'll throw him out. I was at the winter meetings 4 years ago, Rick, when they honored Johnny Gorrell with the Mike Kulbaugh Award, which is an award they give out that honors an individual who, you know, has great baseball work ethic and knowledge of the game and has mentored young players. That was the purpose of the award.
Gotcha.
And the whole Indians front office went to that award ceremony because it was Johnny Gorrell. They all wanted to be there. They stayed later than they would have normally been at the winter meetings for, but they all wanted to be there for him.
Yeah, well, he's a special man, no doubt about it. This organization very lucky to have him. Came up, he managed, you know, with the Minnesota Twins. He was with the Twins before coming over to this organization.
Tyler Naquin looks at a ball up and away, and the count evens at 1-1. And Johnny would blush at all this attention we're giving him. He prefers to, you know, work behind the scenes and sort of be anonymous because.
He's a baseball guy. That's it.
Because he knows how many hundreds of guys are working throughout the organization that go unnoticed and unrecognized, that are play key roles in developing players to get them to the big leagues.
I'd love to sit down and talk to Johnny about saber metrics and things, how the game is, you know, changing and evolving into something different and new. I'd love to sit down and just chat with him about it.
Well, we talked a little bit about it the other day, Rick. I brought up a stat on, I don't remember which player it was. We were talking about OPS, you know, that on-base plus slugging percentage. That's become a big statistic that nobody ever really thought about before. But getting on base now, drawing walks, has become a real part of the game. Not that it always hasn't. I mean, when we were kids, we always knew a walk's as good as a hit, that thing. But now it's being maybe emphasized more than it maybe ever has been before.
Yeah, but I can see something changing in that game too. For Moneyball, it's where they're getting more aggressive and putting swings on early in the count instead of trying to get the 4, 5, 6 pitches in that bat. I see many more hitters getting more aggressive than they have been.
And that's where the other part of that stat is, on base plus slugging percentage.
Right.
So the ability to get on base and hit for power. Tyler Naquin working the count here.
Let's add one more to that stat. Minus strikeouts. Make it something that that brings back something with the strikeout. How about that?
The 3-2 pitch. And Naquin draws a one-out walk. And we'll turn it over to the top of the order. T-Mobile, greater coverage of baseball. Well, we're going to see this guy very soon. Kyle Seager. Woo, is he on fire. 11 out of 16 against the Padres. And you have to wonder, you know, is the Padres pitching in sort of the same state maybe where the Reds pitching was when the Indians faced Cincinnati?
Boy, I don't know, but you would have to think so. As many runs as they've been giving up. How about 12-2? That's a comeback of the ages. I remember when the Indians did something like that to the Seattle Mariners.
To Seattle, yeah.
August 5th of, let me think, 2001.
Yeah.
That was an 8-pitch at bat for Tyler Naquin.
And for Naquin, just his third walk this year.
Yeah, he's been an aggressive.
Well, that's when I had to look it up and think, I don't remember him walking a whole lot. That's only his third.
Carlos Santana walked his first time up. And now he drives one to deep center, but there is Lorenzo King. And there are two down.
I want to send along a very special happy birthday wish to Arlene Pimsner of Rocky River, turning 100 today. So Arlene, happy birthday.
Happy 6th anniversary to Melissa and Greg Wisenai. They're at the game tonight, brought their son Andrew to his first ball game. They're celebrating their 6th anniversary, so the whole gang's here. Kipnis lifts it near the line. Dyson on the run makes the catch. And that will end the inning. No runs, no hits, a man left. We've played four. Cleveland leads it by three. Levin Furniture, for the best deals on furniture and mattresses, shop Levin's. By your Northern Ohio Honda dealers. And by the Cleveland Clinic. Access anytime, anywhere. Fifth inning. And what a night. Big crowd on hand. And the Indians lead over the world champs 4-1. Chesler Cuthbert walked his first time up and he takes the first pitch strike. And Rick, I don't know if something clicked in after the Drew Butera homer, but Salazar has been kind of a different pitcher. And I know in talking to Yan Gomes, he said Salazar, he said sometimes, he said, you know, he'll give up a home run and then he'll just get mad. And he said then it's just like boom. Yeah. He just gets angry and he starts throwing harder. And guys just can't hit him.
Well, I'm glad, because what happened, he gave up the home run and his offense came back and got him three. So he got mad at the right time. He's given up four home runs this year. All the home runs have been solo that he's given up. So those aren't bad.
No.
You know, you challenge a guy and all of a sudden, boom, you get one. And that I don't know if the wake up call goes on in your head or what, but he has settled in. That's the only hit he's given up.
Swung on and missed. He's got another strikeout, number five on the night. I suppose it's not all that different from, you know, they talk about boxers. And sometimes a boxer will get into the ring and, you know, you're kind of jockeying for position. All of a sudden you get one right in the kisser. And
yeah.
All of a sudden,
yeah.
Like you said, the bell goes off and look out now.
Yes.
Hit at third, Uribe trying to take the bunt away from Dyson, who took a mighty hack but fouled it back. Dyson has such great speed that if you're Uribe, you almost have to play in until you get to two strikes. Because if you give him that bunt, he'll take it. But interestingly enough, Rick pointed out, Dyson, it won't happen here. But he is grounded into double plays in his last two at bats in this series.
That's hard to believe. That's a rarity you'll see from this guy. Unless it's just one hopper right at somebody. And both of them ended up being big plays.
Yeah, last night it was in that. Was it in the eighth inning last night? Yeah. And he went around the horn, 5-4-3.
That's hard to do.
And that was Jose Ramirez, I think, that started that one. And then here tonight, it was a smash to Lindor, who took it himself to second and threw on to first. One ball, two strikes. Ground ball right at Kipnis. And he'll take care of Dyson, two down. Drew Butera led off the third inning. Was it first pitch?
Second pitch. Yeah, it was a hanging break.
Boom.
Curveball. He hit it out. Look at him. He's mad right there.
Since then, nada. He has retired eight straight. And striking out three of them. And now Butera digs in.
He's reaching back now. That was about what, 96, 97?
Mm-hmm. Up high. Butera lays off 2-0.
I think right there, Danny just wants to show him, hey, I hung my curveball. It's my fault. I'm coming right at you now with my good stuff. Hit this. But I think he tried to overthrow the first couple of pitches.
Shakes him off a couple of times, the 2-1, and a good fastball. He's staying all heaters in this at bat, but hasn't been able to locate it as well as he'd like. So Butera can kind of narrow the scope here. And he pops up the 3-1 fastball. Right field, Lonnie Chisenhall. 9 up, 9 down since the homer allowed by Salazar. And it's 4-1 Cleveland. As you get a look out at the district, the corner, on the right field.
Where's Andre?
Lindor chops one to the second baseman Merrifield. One away. In-game recap brought to you by your local Toyota dealers. Yan Gomes got the Indians on the board first with a solo homer in the second inning, his seventh of the year. But then the Royals countered with a solo dinger of their own. Indians roared back in the third. Lindor with an RBI knock. Napoli drives one home off the wall. Third run scored on a wild pitch. It's a 4-1 Indians lead. Ask where Andre was. I see the guys down there in that right field corner by the foul pole. They're building the Miller Lite.
They got
pyramid.
The pyramid again. Yeah. That was last week we were here, right? We came home for the long homestand, so it's back to back weekends.
Napoli look out! Smashes one into the crowd. Lays off 3-1. Edinson Volquez now at 85 pitches on the right, 48 for strikes. Full count. He gave up the home run to Yan Gomes. There were two outs in that second inning. The solo shot. And then with one out in the third, it was four consecutive hits with a wild pitch mixed in that accounted for the Indians' other three runs. And now another walk.
That's four tonight. That's what he had last time he started against the Indians, four walks. Well, KeyBank Kids tickets start at just $10 for kids 12 and under with the purchase of an adult ticket. Kids tickets located in the family deck at Progressive Field and are only available at Indians.com.
She says, give me a slug of that. Oh, she's not happy about whatever it is. Ramirez pulls it foul. Man's got his jersey on backwards. I guess he wants Hosmer to know he's wearing it.
That could be.
Jose Ramirez lined out his first time up and then another base hit in the third. Takes a strike there and he's in the hole 0-2. Two strike pitch. And Ramirez chops it to second. Whitfield goes to Escobar. And a double play ends the inning. Five complete. It's the Indians four and the Royals one.
continue tomorrow night. 12,500 fans will get a 76 throwback jersey. Post-game fireworks show will take place after the ball game, and it'll pay tribute to the late David Bowie, Glenn Frey, and Prince. Visit Indians.com for the tickets.
I saw the 76 jerseys the Indians are going to wear, and they're sweet. They've got the 1976 bicentennial patch on.
Oh, yeah. Those are great unis. They had red. They had blue. Blues were very nice.
Did you guys have a white top, or was it just red and blue?
No, we had a white top, too. Sure.
And then were the pants all white, or did you have any?
They had all white, but they had red. We never saw.
The reds were just 75, or did you wear them in 76?
No, 76.
Too?
Okay. And
I remember sometimes there was a really
bad. 77. I think when Torborg was the manager, they tried to wear the red pants with the blue tops.
Yeah, that's what I remember.
Atrocious.
That was not good.
No, it was bad.
That didn't work well.
Very bad. I blame Jeff.
Red tops, though, there's a special place in a lot of Indians fans'
well,
hearts.
Well, no doubt.
Bloop center. Lindor and Kipnis almost collided. They couldn't get to it.
Perfectly placed.
It's the first hit of the series for Alcides Escobar, and it snaps a string of 9 in a row, retired by Salazar.
Yeah, it's only the second hit tonight. Yeah, you couldn't have thrown that ball out there any better than Escobar hit it. For Salazar, the first two times through the lineup, first time 31 pitches, second time 34 pitches. So starting this inning with 65. Has 7 outs on 3 pitches or less.
And now Whit Merrifield, who walked in the first, flied to left in the third. Tell me that is the 1,000th career hit for Alcides Escobar.
Well, he's a good player.
Good pitch, but didn't get called. 1-1.
1,000 hits, and he's an excellent shortstop. Congratulations. Pretty nice milestone.
Yeah. And that will get out of play. Ichiro's got to be getting close to 3,000, right?
Yes. Yeah, every day he gets closer. He's inside 40, I know that.
He's 35 hits away, I'm told officially.
Okay.
Chopped up the middle. Lindor cuts it off, flips the Kipnis for one, back to first, not in time.
All right, tough one to turn. Nice attempt, nice effort, both by Lindor and Kip. Kip had his back to the infield. That's what makes it so tough, because that ball had enough top spin to get past him. He had to make the backflip, and you see Kipnis not even looking right there. That can be scary too with a guy coming down.
One on, one out. Lorenzo Cain, the batter, 0-for-2 tonight. I wonder if the new slide rule, though, has put the middle infielders at ease, or if it takes time for that to happen.
I would think it'd take a little time. I mean, it's not like it used to be where they can come roll block you and you have to worry about it. But you know what? You can hear them coming. And I don't care if it's a close game, and then I was a middle infielder, I'd be a little concerned about it.
Especially if your back's to the plate.
Right.
You don't
hear. I mean, you don't see anything.
That's line left. Back goes Ramirez and makes the catch in the middle of the warning track. Scampering back to first is Whit Merrifield, and now Ramirez can say, see how it feels, Lorenzo?
Well, he was playing deep.
first baseman Eric Costa.
He was playing him deep and caught it on the track. It was hit hard by Kane. I was going to say this is a big inning here to get through Kane and Hosmer, and it looked like he didn't catch it right in the pocket. Then had a little wiggle room. You know, you got to ask him how different it is. You know, when you play the infield, you play with a smaller glove,
right?
You know, and it's a little weird when you got a bigger glove. You need it in the outfield because that ball, you know, when you're running, it'll bounce up and down on you. So sometimes it takes a while to get used to the big glove. And you know he comes in a lot of games and plays third base. You know, in the seventh or eighth inning when they have the lead for Uribe, and he's changing gloves and a little bit different. Got good hands, so you can catch him barehanded.
Another 1-0 pitch. Well, when you go back and look at the guys who played in the 30s and 40s and look at some of the gloves they wore, it's like, how did they catch anything?
It was only just the indentation of the ball. That's when you use two hands.
Yeah, I understood.
That's how you were taught as a kid. Hey, use two hands to catch that ball. Why? Because the gloves stink.
Because there's no pocket.
Yeah.
Better catch.
Yeah, you needed the help because they're going to roll around in there.
What do they call that in the Rawlings? The trapeze?
Yeah, that's his. No, the six finger, the trapeze. Exactly. But you know, the gloves have the creases now, and I mean, they're just, even catcher's gloves are so much different.
Yeah, just think about trying to catch Bob Feller in 1936 when he's throwing 100 and whatever miles an hour.
Well, think of the bone bruises and all the veins that you busted in your hand.
Those poor guys.
As catchers, yeah.
Was it Frankie Pitlack? All those guys? Mike Hegan's dad?
Jim Hegan, right.
There's a walk to Hosmer. Second time they've walked him tonight. Fourth time already in the first two games of the series.
Well, that's pretty much probably don't give him anything to get him back into the game, but now he's got to come make his pitches here. It's okay to walk him if you get your next guy out. But he has two outs in the inning.
And while Kendry Morales has struggled with the overall batting average, he still has six home runs.
Well, and they bring the tying run to the plate in this situation.
And the Indians shift the infield. Kipnis really pulled around to the right with Santana. You see Lindor shading him up the middle. And he hits it right at Frankie. He'll go to Kip, and that's the inning ending force. Middle of the sixth. It remains Cleveland 4, Kansas City 1.
KeyBank Kids Fun Day. Kids can run the bases post-game thanks to Cleveland Clinic's Children's. Visit Indians.com for all the details.
Lonnie Chisenhall will lead it off for Cleveland here in the bottom of the sixth inning. He is 0 for 2 tonight. He drove one to deep center in the second that Lorenzo Cain ran down, struck out his last time on. Fouled off of his foot. Kansas City bullpen is quiet for the moment. As you see, Volquez closing in on that 100 pitch mark.
Okay, stop filming that.
Cincinnati's getting a well pitched game from Finnegan. They're shutting out the Nationals 5-0 in the sixth.
Wow. You know, that kid has a chance to be a really good pitcher, I think.
Lonnie went fishing down and in. Good pitch by Volquez, his fifth strikeout tonight. One away. The all-new Fox Sports app is your way to get baseball highlights, interviews, injury updates, scores, instant alerts, everything you need to follow your favorite team. Download in the App Store or visit foxsports.com/app. Tigers lead the White Sox 3-2 in Detroit there in the sixth inning.
Again, that's all day.
I was just going to say.
That's all night long.
Juan Uribe can't help himself. He keeps checking his swing and they keep calling him strikes. He ropes that one foul.
You think the chance he might get a breaking ball away are here in this situation.
That's what he's calling for.
Well, you know what?
My bad.
Yeah, he put the breaking ball up, but Volquez was just going to hold it a little extra.
Yeah. Cut under that one and backed up on him, but it's out of the strike zone, 1-2.
He had the right idea originally. He hasn't touched it yet, so why stop throwing it? He hasn't made the adjustment. See, you got a young guy, and Volquez likes to do his own thing out there, so I'm sure him and Perez have worked so many times together, they're used to it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and now with Butera behind the plate, it's a little different.
Fastball.
The show fastball.
Didn't miss by much either. Volquez kind of snapped it back. I think he thought maybe.
Well, he was either going to make a perfect pitch with it or it was going to be away. Come back with another breaking ball here, I would think.
Yep. There it is, and a broken bat. Oh, my. Cuthbert throws him out. The barrel of the bat sawed in half, and half of it ended up about 15 feet away from Cuthbert.
Well,
it was
traveling about as far as the ball. You know, and it was about the same speed. He had to worry about that, but you can see it checked down into the grass.
That's a great shot of the spin on that breaking ball.
It's a great shot of the toothpick he has in his hand.
You can see Cuthbert back on his heels as he saw the bat hurtling towards him.
Yeah. You never know, but you could have one eye on that ball and one eye on the bat.
Yan Gomes homered to the bleachers and left his first time up, grounded out to third base his last time up. Third time through the order, it's been a different story for Volquez. Only one Indians hitter has reached to this point. And that was Mike Napoli, who walked and then was erased on a double play. Now Kansas City's bullpen getting loose as Volquez is going over the 100 pitch mark. Back in the second inning. This was the first run of the game.
Looked like a little two-seam fastball to Yan Gomes. His seventh given up by Volquez.
Gomes to center. Routine play. 1-2-3 go the Indians. We played six. It's Cleveland 4, Kansas City 1.
Injury lawyers at Elk and Elk, proud partner of the Cleveland Indians. Call 1-800-ELK-OHIO. By Ford, built Ford tough. And by Subway, fresh is what we do.
Roger Dorn is here, I see.
Yes, he is.
On the bottom of your screen.
He's on the left field drink rails. Well, he was a third baseman, so that's why.
Paulo Orlando 0-for-2 on the night, leads off here in the seventh. Danny Salazar, his 81st pitch of the night, a strike.
You know, especially with Danny tonight, he has 4 walks, 5 strikeouts. He's going into the seventh at the 80 pitch mark pretty good.
Kansas City's probably saying this is eerily similar to the last time we saw Danny Salazar.
Right. You know, Danny just a hair over 17 pitches per inning on the year.
Except in that game, he pitched almost 8 innings. He went 7 2/3, which is a season high. He was obviously a little more efficient. He only gave up 4 hits. He's only given up 2 tonight.
Well, he's a tough guy to put the ball in play. He had those starts earlier in
wicked.
The year.
That never. Was wicked. Rick, I can't tell a lot of times if it's a changeup or a breaking ball, but that thing had some nasty movement to it.
That's the changeup.
Yeah. Well, Andre came back from the district. I don't know why, but he did.
Neither do I. Man, I want to stay there till Sunday morning. I heard you guys talking earlier, though, about Danny and the conversation, Matt, you had with Yan Gomes about when he gets mad. Well, over the last couple of starts, he's allowed 19 hits in his past 3 starts after giving up less than 4 in his first 7. Mm-hmm. He told me he's okay with that, though, because that means he's around the strike zone more than he was in the previous starts that we were talking about.
That is deep. Hits the base of the wall. Lonnie plays it well. Makes a good strong throw, and they got him! Are you kidding me? That ball hit the base of the wall, and Lonnie Chisenhall made a phenomenal play and a deadly accurate throw to nail him at second base.
The play is made because Chisenhall gave up and didn't try to catch the ball. He knew it was going to be over his head. Watch him stop and play it off the wall.
There it is. He made the decision. I can't get to it. Let me play it off the wall. Came right back to him. A nice pick by Lindor. It was a short hop, but a great throw and accurate, as you say. And that's a single and throw him out at second. Nice play, Lonnie. Well done.
I love the look on Cuthbert's face. He's looking out there going,
are you kidding?
Who just threw me out?
He played it beautifully off the wall.
Lonnie Chisenhall, a.k.a. the Cobra.
Well, you know, it was coming back in. He knew it was on target. But the key is he didn't go. He didn't run himself into the wall. He let it come back to him. It's a double anyway until you make a perfect throw like that. And that's the 12th outfield assist for the Indians this year. Second for Chiz.
And a strike called to Dyson, who is 0 for 2 tonight. Inside, he missed. And a two out base runner for Drew Butera.
At the plate for the Royals, number 9, Drew Butera.
Butera homered in the third. It's the only run of the game for Kansas City. I don't think he's seen a breaking ball since.
No, he won't see another breaking ball because, you know, it upset him. He hung him one. I mean, it wasn't a good breaking ball.
Last time up, it was all heaters.
Well,
boom,
why wouldn't it be? And what did he do? He flew out to right field.
On a 3-1 pitch,
yeah.
He popped it. Yep. Another heater,
you know,
0-2.
He's hitting ninth for a reason. You know, and I know Danny's just upset he made a bad pitch and he hurt him. That goes to show you it doesn't matter where you hit in the line. If you make a mistake to a big league hitter, they can take you out of the ballpark. So sometimes, and I'm sure that's probably what slapped him in the, you know, in the back of the head to says, hey, man, that's a number 9 here. You're throwing him a breaking ball. And there's your changeup.
But he's 0-2 with that changeup and no chance to hit it for Butera. Lonnie Chisenhall with a phenomenal throw as the Indians roll on stretch time in Cleveland.
Four-one, the Indians lead it. Folks doing a seventh inning stretch between innings.
And the Indians go to bat with Tyler Naquin leading it off.
Yeah, big night, fireworks to follow. And I see Volquez back out there, you know, probably going to try and rest that bullpen for Ned Yost.
Chen Ming Wong is getting loose. Former Yankee right-hander. Low 2-0. See Naquin sort of caught in between.
Well, he was on a 2-0 pitch. He was not. That was a fastball, so I don't know if he wanted to hold up. You got to let it go.
That's where you second guess yourself. You see a fastball, you say, oh yeah, it's a fastball. And then maybe somewhere in the back of your mind is like, no, maybe it's not a fastball. And you just,
too late.
That moment's hesitation and you're all messed up.
There's not that much time. You just see, react is what you do.
Line to deep left center field. Dyson looking up. Goodbye! Tyler Naquin with an opposite field shot to the bleachers, and the Indians extend their lead to 5-1.
Well, that's his first career home run. How about that? They're not going to give him a silent treatment. They like it because it was Oppo. That went to left field. He put it, you know what, that 2-0 swing. He came back, and whatever adjustment he made, he put on a great swing on that 3-1. First major league home run. Congratulations, Tyler Naquin. Makes it a 5-1 ball game.
Little oppo pop for Tyler Naquin.
Second solo homer of the night for the Tribe. Who's chirping in there?
Balls in the dirt.
Take a look at this swing. That's a little two-seamer going away, and Volquez know he hit it well. But boy, that ball carried very well. That didn't just get over there. That's not easy to do going oppo that way. Look at, boys are happy for him. Kipnis, there's Lindor. They meet him right at the top step.
I like the one we saw earlier on the homestand, the young man from Baltimore, Kim.
They didn't talk to him for about 30 seconds, and that was his first, big league home run. We've seen a lot of guys on this homestand hit, early home runs so far this year.
Drew Butera hit his first last night, his second tonight.
Yeah, right. Butera, Profar hit his first. Kim hit his first. And then it was Cuthbert hitting his second yesterday, and Holiday with Texas. Rua hit his third, and Reimold hit his fourth. All on this homestand. So summer months, getting warmer maybe.
Did you say Lonnie Chisenhall?
I did not say
Chisenhall. He hit his first on this homestand.
That's right.
Santana hit it hard, but right at Hosmer. One down here in the bottom of the seventh with Cleveland on top 5-1. And Jason Kipnis heading to the plate. Tommy's all over this leading off the inning stat.
Is he?
And that's the sixth time the Indians have led off an inning with a home run. On this homestand. On this homestand in particular, so.
Well, after tonight, two more games to go. It's one of the longest home stands of the year. It's been nice to stay here for a while, hasn't it? It's two weekends in a row.
And the weather's just been ideal.
Yes, it has.
Jason Kipnis with a line drive base hit, so he has two knocks tonight.
We'll see if Leos goes and gets him now.
He's on the top step.
Yeah, he's got to. He's had enough. He tried to go out there and maybe save him a little bit with that bullpen, but it's time to go get him.
Oquez goes 6 1/3. And, you know, outside of this inning, which he gave up the home run, the solo homer to Gomes and the four straight hits in the third, he hasn't allowed any other hits. It's just been weird the way the Indians have been able to get to him tonight. But it's a 5-1 Cleveland lead, and the Cleveland Clinic call to the bullpen has been made for Chin-Ming Wong here in the seventh. He'll talk about the Memorial this weekend. He'll have tips for your game inside the Golf Zone presented by American Eagle Mortgage and Varmengard. Sundays at 8 on Fox Sports Ohio. One on, one out. Francisco Lindor to the plate. He'll be facing Chin-Ming Wong. This was a kind of a good low risk signing for the Royals in the offseason. Bring him in, see if he's got anything, you know, kind of left in the tank.
Well, they've been trying to protect their bullpen, and maybe a double play here.
Back to first, they turn two, and that ends the inning. But Tyler Naquin with his first major league home run. It makes it a 5-1 Indians lead.
Indians and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. And the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without the express written consent of the Cleveland Indians. It's a 5-1 Indians lead. And now we go to the eighth inning. Danny Salazar back out there. Indians have action in the bullpen. Danny just shy of 100 pitches on the night. Borzolotti the lefty and Brian Shaw of course from the right side. Alcides Escobar swing and a miss. Popped him up back and out of play. Checked his swing. Look out on deck circle.
Not much you can do or say except pay attention.
Swung on and missed.
Nice pitch.
That's strikeout number 8 for Salazar. One gone in the eighth inning.
Now look at this changeup. You get to 2 strikes and this pitch is just it's one of the best in the game without a doubt, because it's tough when you're throwing 95 plus. And you see that pitcher trying to get the barrel out of the batter, just foul off a fastball and the bottom just drops out of it. Tough to catch up to. 8 strikeouts for Salazar. He has 14 swings and misses tonight. And he has 5 walks. And he's just over the 100 pitch mark. You can see it. I said on the year about 17 pitches per inning, but he's been very tonight, all things considered, with the strikeouts and the walks in there, that's pretty impressive.
Bullseye, 2-1. It in. Merrifield backed out of the way quickly. Bullseye and a full count. So Danny Salazar, he knows he's nearing the finish line tonight.
Yeah, his first full count of the night.
Oh, I got a piece of it. That was nasty again.
Well, that's about all you want to do if you're a hitter. Get that changeup, get a piece. That's what you call, hey, staying alive, man. Live for one more pitch. And Witt's going to do that.
Fastball found straight back. He's staying alive. Sometimes you get in a bat like this late in the game when a guy's starting to run out of gas.
run that pitch count up, and that could hasten his exit from the ballgame. Blew it by him.
Well, that meant something to Salazar. You see him, he had a almost like patted himself on the back there.
Number 9 for Salazar.
You know, he got the pitch. He saw the swing and miss and watched him say yes. There it was, a little pump me up there with his glove. Elevated the fastball, got it by him.
And Lorenzo Cain 0 for 3.
See if he can go out in style.
And it takes a look, it's low, ball one.
You mentioned for Salazar, his longest start of the year against these Royals back on May 6th, 7 2/3 innings. He's sitting there right now.
Yeah, I didn't think he was going to have a chance to get this deep into the ball.
Well, look at the strikeouts and the walks.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the amazing thing. 9 strikeouts, 5 walks.
And let's see, pitch count wise, Rick, at 110. He's made as many as 114. That was back in April. Boom. Fastball in there, it's 2-1. And that was just overpowering. 97 miles an hour.
He's emptying the tank is what he's doing, man. He wants it. I could tell after that last strikeout when he came back and he finally got the strikeout. He's emptying the tank right here. Crowd wants to see it.
Chopped to short. Lindor fires low. Dug out by Santana. A season high 8 innings for Danny Salazar. And the Indians lead it 5-1 as he sets him down 1-2-3. Performance here tonight. He went 8 innings. Gave up 1 run on only 3 hits. The last time he faced him, he gave up 4 hits, but he didn't give up a run. Tonight, fewer hits, but he did allow the 1 run on a solo homer. And the way the Royals have been swinging the bats, you can say tonight's performance is better.
Yeah, I would agree with that. He knows that the run he gave up tonight was his mistake. It was a bad pitch. But boy, he settled in nicely.
Now 1-1 now to Mike Napoli. And he hammers one a deep left field, caught by Dyson in the middle of the warning track.
Yeah, he got one over his head earlier today.
That baby had some top spin to it.
Yes, it did.
It's Miller time, brought to you by Miller Lite. Back in that third inning when the Indians erupted, it was four straight hits. Francisco Lindor drove home Jason Kipnis. Napoli blasted one to left, driving home Lindor. Ramirez had a base hit, and then with Lonnie Chisnall at the plate, Napoli scores from third on the wild pitch. With a hit tonight, Jose Ramirez. And now he's looking for two hits, and he's got it. A two-hit night as he goes into second base with a one-out double. Ramirez with a five-game hitting streak, but Rick, he has nine hits in his last 19 at-bats.
Well, there you go. It was a high breaking ball from Wong, and he keeps it fair inside the line, then it'll bounce off this railing. Oh, nice one out double.
How about the homestand he's having? Jose Ramirez is 14 for 28. By far the most hits of any Indians player on this homestand. There's Lonnie Chisnall. He doesn't have a hit, but man, he made a phenomenal play in right field. First to play the carom as well as he did. And then a lights out throw to second to nail Chesler Cutler. Ramirez is going to third, and a throw gets away, and the Indians will get another run. Ramirez with a steal, a bad throw, and it's 6-1 Cleveland.
He takes off and he throws from his knees. It's a clear path, but Cuthbert couldn't stop the ball from getting in the left field. It'll be an error on Butera. Fourth error in two games for the Royals. They normally do not make mistakes, but they do right there.
Ronnie shoots one to the second baseman Merrifield. Two down. Our keys to the game recapped by Mazda. Control the bottom of the Royals order. The 6-9 guys killed them last night, going 9-for-16 tonight. 2-for-10, they have accounted for the only run of the game. And offensively, the Indians did a nice job. They had that one stretch we just showed you. Four straight hits in the third. Made it a 4-1 ball game. Gave Danny Salazar some breathing room, and he breezed tonight. Juan Uribe is 0-for-3 in the ballgame. And he chops one up the middle. Cut off by Escobar from the bag. He'll throw him out. And just like that, we'll go to the ninth. Cleveland 6, Kansas City 1.
The Royals, as we head to the ninth inning, Brian Shaw coming on for Danny Salazar, Jensen Lewis, Al Pawlowski. Speaking of Danny Salazar, boy, what an effort tonight. Eight innings, other than one pitch in which a solo homer was hit. The Royals didn't have much success against him.
All three pitches working again tonight. I thought that's the best changeup of his career. And it just the way he had it set up with his fastball command, we talked about on Indians Live. And then playing from in front, you know, Yan Gomes, he's starting to put it together again and then adding on. They responded after Butera's solo homer, gave him all the cushion he needed.
Speaking of Indians Live, that's coming up next after this one. It's brought to you by Conrad's Tire Express and Total Car Care. For the ninth inning call, let's send it back upstairs to Matt and Rick. Fellas.
Hey, Al, ask Jensen, when you're in the bullpen just chilling, you watch a guy like Danny go out and deal like he is tonight. Do you ever just kick your feet back up and say, there's no need for us tonight, boys?
Yes. Yes, you do. This is a great feeling, especially on a Friday night. You get to take in all the ballpark has to offer. So I thought you might say
maybe a Saturday day game after a Friday night.
Yeah. And you know, guys, with the rain coming tomorrow, too, you're kind of on edge because you want to be fresh going into tomorrow. But, yeah, that's an easy one tonight. Kick back, relax.
Well, they've had a lot to admire both on the field and off because the ballpark is hopping. Big crowd, fireworks coming up after the game. Royals, the world champs in town with first place at stake in the division. Indians began the night just a game back in the loss column. But because the Indians still have played the fewest games in the league, they're a game and a half back overall. And it's been a lot of fun. This series has been terrific for the Indians. What a stunning come from behind win last night was. And tonight they scored first. They've never trailed. Danny Salazar just brilliant. And Eric Hosmer with a bouncer to second. And a quick out here in the ninth for Brian Shaw.
Our Pat O'Brien play of the game. Why not? Tyler Naquin. Nothing like the first time.
No kidding. And he went oppo too, opposite field, 3-1 count.
Think nice. About that, your first major league homer. And
he earned it.
Oppo Popo.
Look at everybody's happy there.
Pitch up and away. Two, one, broke his bat. Boy, it's been a tough night for Kenry Morales as he goes 0 for 4 and now 0 for 8 in the series. Two down. For Paolo Orlando. Well, this crowd of 24,753 rising up. They've had a ball at the yard here tonight. Strike call. And a foul right back. Other than the first game of the year against Boston, this is the biggest crowd we've had here at Progressive Field. And now they're just one strike away from celebrating a big win here early in the month of June.
fouled to the seats. Santana gave it a look, but not going to get there. The set by Shaw and the two strike pitch just missed with a high heater. And now the count 1-2. Again, the 1-2 pitch. Hit on the ground at first. Santana's got it. Shaw beats him to the bag, and this game is over. The Indians win it. They've taken the first two from the world champs, and they've closed the gap to a half game on first place in the AL Central. Six, one is the final score tonight. As the Indians go to 29-24, and Kansas City, who's played one more game than Cleveland, is 30-24. Edinson Volquez taking the loss for KC. He drops to 5-5. Danny Salazar is the winner, and he goes to 6-3 on the year.
Boy, you got to love it. Salazar, another great start. Naquin got his first major league home run. A lot of good things happened tonight. They took the early lead. Leon Gomes hit a home run to give them a 1-0 lead. They've got some nice energy flowing right now in that dugout. I got to tell you that.
Yeah, you're right, Rick. This is the way you've got to beat Kansas City. Team effort, and there were a lot of different people involved for the Indians here tonight. First and foremost was the pitching of Danny Salazar. 8 innings, 1 run allowed on just 3 hits. Walked 5, 1 was intentional, struck out 9. And the Indians win it by a final score of 6-1. We'll be back with some final thoughts right after this.